Welcome everyone to the Azure AD B2C Architecture Deep Dive Series. I'm Harsh Asija, Program Manager in the Azure AD Engineering Team at Microsoft.
I am Mukunda Murthy. I am also a Program Manager in the Azure AD Engineering Team. We both are part of Customer Experience Program. In Azure AD B2C, we have built many resiliency features to help your service scale to your business needs and remain resilient. However, when launching a critical application, it is important to consider various design and configuration elements. Harsh, what are some of the ways in which applications and policies could be configured for resiliency?
Hey, Mukunda, that's an important topic that you brought up. Let us take a look at how we can address this. To start with, we suggest methods of providing resilient end-user experiences. This involves providing a failback plan for your authentication. Next, we will look at how we can solidify your interaction with downstream services, REST APIs, and how to handle those errors gracefully. Next, we'll also look at some of the best practices that you can deploy in terms of policy development. Lastly, we'll talk about the benefits of longer-lived web sessions and token lifetimes. Mukunda, how do our customers build resilience for authentication?
Let's start from looking at the authentication flows. We recommend you choose built-in user flows if your business requirements can be met. User flows are extensively tested by Microsoft. That reduces the testing needed by you for validating the user flows. However, you still need to test your applications for performance and scale. Now, what if there is a potential disruption with the IDP? Let me tell you, here is how you can build a fallback plan to switch from one IDP to another. First step, configure your signup policy to allow sign up by both local account and external IDPs, and then configure a policy to link accounts when the users sign in. During an outage, you should notify the users and allow them to switch to an alternate IDP. Now, what if there is a potential outage with your phone provider? Here is what you can do. Let us say you are using built-in user flows. During an outage, change from phone-based to email-based OTP delivery and redeploy the user flows. If you prefer changing your applications, you need to define two sets of user flows, one set using phone OTP and the second with email OTP. During an outage, you can update your application to point to the fallback user flow. If you are using custom policies, you should expose both options to your users and let them self-select between the two. Note that there is no need to make changes to the policies or applications. Now that we made our authentication flow resilient, let's continue through the user journey, which interfaces with external processes and downstream services, and how to make those resilient. First, when calling an interface to get data, check whether the data is essential for authentication decisions. If they are essential, you must place sufficient protection for denial of service attacks in front of your APIs. If the data is non-essential, move the call to the application logic. You now have reduced the dependency in the authentication path. Next, expect API failures and build error handling. You should rely on HTTP status code and return the appropriate 400 series response if the API is unresponsive. You should notify the users with a friendly guidance on when they could retry. The REST API technical profile allows you to configure error messages for various circuit breakers. Now, what if you have several downstream services? Here, we recommend that you place an API gateway. You can scale out API deployments by using gateways caching and load balancing. Most gateways also handle authentication to provide secure access to the backend services and microservices. Azure API Gateway has a built-in integration with Azure AD B2C. Next, how can you make accessing the web content resilient? Let me tell you that. We recommend using content delivery networks for storing and rendering assets that are needed for your user experience. CDNs are better performant and content is delivered faster from a geographically distributed network. We recommend you routinely test CDN's availability, performance, and conduct load testing. Now, what if there is an upcoming high traffic season and you need to scale your service? You should estimate peak load rates of directory reads and writes and all the calls to your downstream services. Your estimate should also include actions such as sign up, sign in, and multi-factor authentication. By keeping the traffic under the limits for an application or a tenant, you can avoid throttling. Be sure to test end-to-end for peak traffic. Harsh, what do you recommend to developers for reducing the occurrence of throttling?
Yeah, while some of these settings we looked at can be managed by the tenant admins, there are a lot of things that the policy and app developers control which significantly impact the end user experience. I want to start off by talking about rate limits, also referred to as throttling. This is designed to protect your tenant against bad actors from flooding your application or the tenant with a lot of requests, thereby causing resource starvation or attempting to breach a user account. To protect against these type of attacks, the directory implements various levels of throttling at the application and tenant level. For example, if you are writing to the directory to migrate users using client credentials through Microsoft Graph APIs, it is possible that you send too many requests in a given period, your application will get throttled and you will receive a 429 error code. If you do not have real traffic to the tenant, you can potentially add another application with its own client ID and secret to double the speed. You must be careful though. After two applications, any more load can potentially cause you to hit the tenant level max, after which all requests to your tenant will be throttled. It is important that you account for it more so if you are already live and have traffic in production. Make sure that you do not have any negative impact to your existing users. These application and tenant level limits have different thresholds based on the operation you are executing. HTTP GET, for example, will be different than HTTP POST, PATCH, or DELETE. Please check the AAD B2C documentation to understand these limits. If your business case requires changing these limits, you should reach out to Microsoft via your representative or support to update these limits well in time before your next high traffic event. When we talk about throttling and directory operations, it is important to understand that when you create a sign-in or a sign-up journey in custom policies, you are writing a workflow, which is reading and writing from various sources to create and issue a token to the application. So these read, write, delete, update limits that we talked about also apply to custom policies. It is highly advised that you avoid a write operation at all costs during a sign-in. Though there are some scenarios which require you to either create or update a user on sign-in, it should not be done on every request. For example, when a user signs in with a social IDP, the sign-in or sign-up journey might be combined. And if the user does not exist already, we create the user who chose to sign in with Facebook or Google. Another example is just-in-time migration of passwords. where if the user is interacting with Azure AD B2C for the first time, we check if the user is migrated. If not, we write the password in the directory and mark the user as migrated. In both these scenarios, every subsequent sign-in will only be a read operation, and there won't be any writes necessary at the time of sign-in. These condition-based clauses can be orchestrated using a construct called precondition in custom policies, which is like an if-else clause that can help you write conditions and statements that get executed when a condition is met. Scenarios like writing of date time on every login or updating the user on every login is highly discouraged, as those scenarios will work on the surface. But if your application gets a lot of requests in short durations, you could potentially hit these throttling limits. These might not be a concern if your traffic is not high, but if you have millions of users that can get login in burst events like Black Friday, then you should consider following these guidelines. Another topic which can help your applications be resilient to degradation of downstream services is web and token lifetime. These settings can significantly improve the experience for your users that already have a session. When you are setting up user flows or creating custom policies, you have the option to configure SSO behavior, web session behavior, refresh token lifetime, ID token lifetime, and so on. While these settings are very trivial to update thanks to the nice UI or the basic integer-based settings in custom policies, they have a real impact to your end users and how they interact with your application. In a typical code or implicit grant, the application redirects to Azure AD B2C to complete the authentication challenge, and the context is moved from the application to the web-based user flow or custom policies. After completing the challenge, Azure AD B2C sets its web session on the B2C login domain or the custom domain and issues the token to the application. The application validates the token and sets its own session on the application domain. Usually, these sessions are maintained in browser cookies. Anytime a token expires, the application needs to get a new token by again redirecting to the B2C hosted domain. And if the web session from last time is still active, B2C would just issue a new token to the application without any user interaction. This sort of seamless refresh of tokens avoid interruption for the user and also enables your topology to be less resilient on downstream services that are involved as part of the authentication stack. To elaborate, if you are signed in using username and password or Facebook, you had to interact with multiple services in B2C or in Facebook stack to complete the authentication and maybe even do MFA if you had the second factor enabled. Now, while we have a cookie for the B2C web session and it is still active, the Azure AD B2C front-end services can read that cookie and issue a new token that without having to go to the directory or to Facebook again. And in those cases, even if those downstream services are down or experiencing any issues, your app will continue to work normally. The custom policies allow you to control these cookie behaviors and the session behaviors as per your requirement. So understand your security implications as well. You have the option to define that you fetch the claims on every refresh, or you just read from the session and just issue the token directly. These are configured in the session management technical profile of your custom policy. The implicit refresh allows for a web or a single page app to continue to get ID token and access token without user having to enter their username and password again, while if you are using the authorization code grant with or without Pixie, you have the option to get a refresh token which can be used by your application to fetch new ID token and access token programmatically without relying on the web session. Having a long-lived refresh token is quite common And we actually see it in our daily lives when we open an app on our phone. It's still signed in, but it refreshes as we open it. The silent refresh of tokens is done through using refresh token, which the device or the application keeps it in the device keychain or the app's own storage. With that, I want to thank you for your time today, and I want to pass back to Mukunda to provide us a quick recap.
Here are the takeaways. Building fallback plans for authentication ensures the end user experience is not disrupted during an outage of either an IDP or a phone service. Good error handling of REST APIs and downstream services help make your service more resilient. As a developer best practice, optimizing your reads and writes to the directory avoids getting throttled. For users who are already signed in, mitigate disruption by carefully configuring token lifetime and session duration. All these methods help increase the end-to-end resilience of your service. We hope you find this video useful. You are welcome to provide feedback. Please follow the link on the screen. Thank you for taking the time out of your busy day to watch this video, and we wish you good luck in enabling your service to be more scalable and resilient.